in the 1950s under influence of people having being able to go by bus or on a motorcycle, and a situation also in people in which people work in industry or in a bureaucracy. So you see here, for example, someone bringing his kid to school, then going to work, staying there, and going back again. And you see that suddenly, in the course of the 1950s, even in this small village in Norway, you can see that people use a much larger part of the landscape. Now, that is maybe kind of obvious, but if we expand it today, you would have the traditional worker in the mountains in Austria who would do everything on foot, maybe walking with his cows at best, so he would not use large parts of that landscape. So that would produce these kind of traditional villages, here already with a car in it, but basically where people would live close by, a church in the middle, etc. And then you see the tourist, and you see that already this tourist, of course, he comes from outside of the village already, so that means that he uses a much larger part of the landscape. Then there are these cable cars that he uses to lay back all kind of distances. And also, when we look then how he uses the landscape when he goes, for example, skiing, we see that he uses enormous surfaces of this landscape. And probably he goes to a different place for skiing every day, so he uses a large part of that valley. And that produces new villages, that is basically these villages, so these are not farms, but even if they take up the form of traditional farms, so you can see that there's an invented tradition, because it has to look as if it is traditional, but basically these are all big hotels. There's no farming there anymore. And you can see that this village, you can easily imagine that it is much bigger than a traditional village. So you see that what an impact that has. And as we combine that now, you see that suddenly almost the whole of the landscape is used. If we continue that a little bit, and I come back to Laak, the office that I didn't say so much about before, we see this this Landhausplatz, a public space, and you can see that it is, of course, ideal for skating. They had to keep that a secret because the government didn't want it. But because Innsbruck is this tourist and leisure city, there are a lot of innovations in the field of leisure. Notably where snowboarding is concerned, a firm like Burton is in Innsbruck to keep in touch with their audience and the design it needs. Also all kind of innovative freestyle sports are developed here. Freestyle sports are sports that are new, that are in the beginning done by few people that use, so there's no infrastructure, there are no pistes for that yet. That is for people that somehow invent something new. But these freestyle sports become more and more important as we individualize. We have an individualized society and everybody wants to do something else. So it is incredibly important to keep the development of these new sports going. And let's say in skateboarding, that is very much the same. Because when you see people skateboarding, you usually also see that they film each other. And these films are posted on social media, and they may be recreated in a completely different part of the world. So suddenly this, looks like a traditional public space, through the internet has a global effect. And that this effect is also increasingly used by the industry to develop new kind of sports, because the more individual sports you have, the more gear you need, and the more clothes you need, etc., etc., so that generates the production of different styles. So you even have companies now that launch artificially new sports. If you go to this landscape, sports is of course something that is an incredibly irrational activity. I mean, we may think that we keep fit with it, which is partly true, partly we also get all kind of injuries. But here you see that we try to get an idea about how this irrationality of sports work. So again, we try to see this landscape here as a landscape in which these sports happen, but also a landscape in which there are all kinds of myths that are immediately told to the tourists. So this is again a view from my balcony, and here you see this strange rock on this chain of mountains, and this strange rock is called Frau Hit, Mrs. Hit. And there is a story about this woman. She was riding a horse, and she was denying a beggar she did not want to give a beggar money, and in return, because to punish her, she was turned into stone. So you can see here, if you're willing enough, you see this woman sitting on her horse here. So this is basically this mountain that everyone wants to climb or wants to ski from, where Zaha Hadid's cable car is going to, and this is Frau Hit. So here we see this cable car going up there with this gondola. Zaha Hadid stops earlier, you continue with this gondola. You see Innsbruck down there. Then you have all these kind of sports, not just skiing that you can imagine, but you have a very particular sport that is extremely dangerous. Well, a lot of sports that we do are extremely dangerous. Every year there are one or two students that get killed in the sports they do. Mountain climbing too, for example. But this is a very particular sport where you have a very special bicycle. It's called free riding. It is a freestyle sport, and you basically throw yourself off the mountain on this special bike. You have a special harness, a helmet, etc., etc., and you go down as soon as possible over a very narrow path. So basically, when you look at it, you have a very irrational kind of idea. There is a cycle, there are people going up with a machine, then they throw themselves down, and they can get injured or killed. And then once they have done that, they go up again. It is really weird, but this is how Innsbruck makes its money. We even pay a special tax for it. So this cycle reminds of Marcel Duchamp's Large Glass, where you have this bride on top that undresses herself, thus attract the attention of these male the population, and these males want to get in touch with her. They don't manage to, and basically, in the course of these desperate attempts to reach this woman, they die. So this is the cemetery of uniforms and liveries. And see that the bottom part is largely technological. The upper part, where you have the weather report that is shown there, etc., etc., is much more organic. So basically what you see here, and also all kind of notes belong to the Large Glass. So this is one of them. This is a cyclist going up the mountain, and Marcel Duchamp put it on a kind of musical paper to suggest. So basically what you see here then is that you have these cyclists as bikers that want to go up there in this very irrational, death-defying desire. Then they're full of love gasoline, can't reach Frau Hit, and throw themselves off this mountain again. So here you have this special gear that these guys wear. And you have to imagine, this is a typical example of such a sport that is extremely individualized. So they're not. It's not that you see them pass by by the dozens, but this ride is one of the most famous in the world. So you go down with a GoPro, you film yourself, basically you have, nevertheless, on a global scale, all this gear plays an important role. So you have a harness to protect your back, a special helmet, things to protect your legs, etc., etc., and with that you throw yourself down. So basically, here you have your cemetery of uniforms and liveries of the Large Glass again. Then there's the bride, Miss Hit, and Miss Hit is a part of the year she's stripped bare, and part of the year she's covered with snow. So you can say that she is part of the year revealing herself and part not. So basically here you get your new logic, you got the machines that bring you up, the cable car, etc., and then people go around. Good. Now to end all this, because there is this idea about nature, and there is this idea about culture and technology, and in this case about the landscape. So one of our students is actually or was a freestyle skier who was always every year in the in the worldwide top five, and he was from the Italian Olympic team. So basically, this idea of skiing, and I don't know if you have ever skied, is about this relationship with nature, and it looks like this.
Cody drops it.
So this is unbelievable, but we have actually students that can really do this. And here you have to watch, because now you see these rocks coming up. And so this is what these guys do. So this is basically, you see the avalanches coming behind him. So this is an extremely dangerous sport. But it is the sport, of course, if you're a very good skier and you grow up there, you don't want to go with all the tourists, so you climb the mountain yourself, or you have yourself brought there with a helicopter, as is in this case, and you can ski in this pristine snow and this pristine nature. So this is a serious sport, as you can imagine. It's not just James Bond that is doing this. It's these kind of guys that do it for James Bond, as you can imagine. And so you can see that. Yeah, you can see it on film, but that is not so exciting. So what do you do? You have to change nature in such a way that actually you can have an audience watching it. And that is what you have here. So they built a kind of landscaping in which, and then they develop certain rules so that you can have certain aspects of that skiing, if you're a real good skier, that you can use there. So then it looks like this. This is again the students of ours, Paul Fischneller. And you can imagine that this is something that is more down, where you can attract an audience that is overseeable. You have rules, so it becomes clear how these people compete, etc., etc. And still spectacular enough, I would say. So I remember that one summer he was seriously injured with all kind of pins through his legs, and I thought it was seriously handicapped, but in the next winter he was third in the world ranking. So, but still that is a bit up, it can be cold, so you want her to do that. So you bring, and not just that, but it's not just that you want that to see that, but in order for people to do that, they have to get paid, so they have to get sponsored. So you have to arrange for a situation in which, in front of these activities, you can have sponsors. So this is his car, a Suzuki, that he had to park illegally to attract attention, and the parking tickets would be paid by Suzuki as well, not just a car. So then you get this situation. You get, you build huge tribunes, as you can see. There is even lighting, etc. And you get a situation more down, and you can see that the snow is completely artificial. For the rest, the landscape is green, and you get this. So suddenly it has nothing to do with nature anymore, but it becomes a completely urban phenomenon. And these are the same tricks, maybe a bit more spectacular even. And not just that, but you also get new sports that develop that are really urban and that are in which they use these kind of artificial obstacles. So this is a big trend now. It's not just in skiing resorts like Innsbruck, but you would do this in cities like Munich or Moscow or Detroit, not to forget. In Detroit you have no mountains, but they are pulled by a car and they jump from factory to factory. So you get a completely different relationship with something that originally had to do with nature, now becomes a real kind of urban event. And here you see that, so you get even the kind of urban obstacles. It doesn't really matter whether it is a slope. And you get also a new design, because the design, that is something that makes people buy this gear, because the gear itself doesn't change every year. It's like running shoes. So then you get suddenly a situation in which it's consciously presented in a city with graffiti and everything urban that belongs to it, and it becomes a completely urban sport, and the idea of nature is very, very far away. And the intriguing thing about these clips is that the music is the same for all these different clips, as you can see. These are all clips for advertising. So you get a new situation, how you see these people. It doesn't matter who they are individually because they're completely covered. You see a little bit of the face, but it's mostly advertising, the car is in front, etc., etc. And basically, when people have seen that, we would like to buy the same clothes and gear these people have. So you get a completely new situation in which there's a cycle of these kind of skiers that can do that. I can't, I'll be very honest. But of course, it looks very, we want to at least to look as if we could, so that we buy the same stuff. We start doing that. It is seen on television, even far away, and then you travel there, etc., etc. So you get a group of amateurs that is kind of influenced by these people, and you get a completely different use of this landscape. So thank you very much. This is what we do. I hope it wasn't too long, and thank you very much.